It is my privilege to welcome this august gathering of eminent scholars and personalities today at the Distinguished Indologist Award ceremony. This is the third year since the institution of this award by the Indian Council for Cultural Relations, ICCR, in the year 2015, that the ceremony at prestigious Darbar Hall is being organized. Scholars from various nations in the process of understanding India have contributed towards the study and growth of Indology, which is what the Distinguished Indologist Award celebrates. Friends, the study of Indology dates several centuries back, when thinkers from Greek and neighboring countries, traveling through the land and sea routes, or maneuvering through the Arab and Asian countries, first established contacts with the Bharatvarsh, and we are fascinated by its history, archaeology, philosophy, literature, and linguistics. However, Indology as a discipline flourished closer to the 18th century when the European scholars began exploring India's Sanskrit texts and laid foundation for research of Sanskrit and its modern understanding. History of Indology, comprising many eminent scholars from world over and India, including William Jones, Max Muller, R.G. Gangarkar, S. Kuppuswamy Shastri, V.S. Sukhat Shankar, Michael Wiesel, Vasishtha Narayan Jha, to name a few, who dedicated their lives in seeking and promoting knowledge about India and its culture. That India and studying it anchored its scholars and students for lifetime is a testimony of the ability of Indian culture to respect and love one and all, as also bind all in a one large family with the knowledge and wisdom that it has to offer. Speaking about Indology, visual that appears of India is that of traditions and rituals. However, it needs to be mentioned that India is perhaps the only country in the world where traditions have seamlessly merged into a modern society. Today, India is a unique blend of modernity and traditions, with a society deeply rooted in its heritage, history, and culture. Sometimes, India appears as a paradox to scholars, but there is no doubt that scholars who once start studying India fall in love with this complex and extremely diverse country instantly. The ideological perspective, goal-oriented approach, and scientific methodology used in study of various shastras in ancient Indian texts are as enigmatic as relevant to the today's world. Studies and research in Indology were initiated to understand the shastras documented in ancient Indian texts. These shastras, though documented several centuries ago, have not lost their relevance till date. The Vedas and the Upanishads, which are the axis of Indology, speak of inclusiveness and universality. The spirit of universality, explained in the Upanishads, emphasizing on principles of tolerance and resilience, is particularly relevant in today's world, which is gripped with disturbance and is looking for solutions to cohabit and coexist in the world. Yoga and Yoga Shastra, contribution of India's ancient heritage, is a fine example of how not only has this discipline, cutting across the national boundaries, made place for itself world over, but also has provided solutions at individual level when it comes to matters of dealing with physical or emotional stress and overall personal well-being. Understanding the relevance of ancient Indian texts in the present context is at the base of growing interest in studying Indology. Through ICCR, it is our endeavor to send best of the teachers of yoga, Sanskrit, and Veda to countries all over to provide solutions both at the community and individual levels and to spread the message of peace and brotherhood. It's a matter of immense pleasure for us that the third Distinguished Indologist Award is being conferred on a scholar from Japan, a country with which India shares a strong relationship that goes back to 1400 years. I would like to congratulate Professor Hiroshi Marui, on receiving the third Distinguished Indologist Award for his works on Indian philosophy, Indian literature, and Buddhist studies. Congratulations, Dr. Maroi. India's earliest documented direct contact with Japan was with the Todaiji Temple in Nara, where the consecration or eye-opening of the towering statue of Lord Buddha was performed by an Indian monk, Bodhisena, in 752 AD. In the modern times, Indian spiritual leader like Swami Vivekananda, Nobel laureate Rabindranath Tagore, freedom fighter Netaji Subhash Chandra Bose, and judge Radha Vinod Pal have contributed in strengthening the relations between our two great nations. The two countries have built on these values and created a partnership which is unique in many ways. India is the largest democracy and Japan is the most prosperous democracy in Asia. Today, the two countries see each other as strategic partners, and this is expressed in a wide range of contexts and activities. Our annual summits, unique as they are, help in strengthening the political relationship between our two countries. Of the organizations established in 19th century for study and promotion of Indology, such as the Asiatic Society, American Oriental Society, German Oriental Society, the Japanese Association of Indian and Buddhist Studies played an important role in evolution of Indology. Contributions by scholars as Professor Hiroshi of Japan have not only helped in promoting Indology in Japan, but also building bridges between the two cultures, which share a great deal on various planes. I once again welcome Professor Hiroshi Marui and the distinguished audience present here, and wish that the Distinguished Indologist Award will continue to encourage many scholars world over to study India and Indology and help build intercultural and intercivilizational bridges for better understanding of cultures of respective countries. I would also like to thank Mananiya Rashtrapati ji for hosting and blessing this very, very important award ceremony. Thank you.
The winner of this year's Distinguished Indologist Award is Dr. Hiroshi Marui, professor in the Indian Philosophy Department of the University of Tokyo. He has spent more than 40 years working on Indian philosophy, Indian literature, and Buddhist studies. Even today, he is working actively and guiding young Japanese to study Indian philosophy and literature. 5 students have received the doctorates under his guidance. For his research in Nyaya and Vaisesika schools of Hindu philosophy, Dr. Marui was awarded the 23rd Hajime Nakamura's Prize of Eastern Studies in 2013. He has also received the 33rd Prize of Japanese Association of Indian and Buddhist Studies, as well as the 9th Toho Gakkai Prize. Currently, he's the Managing Director of Nakamura Hajime Eastern Institute and the President of the Japanese Association of Indian and Buddhist Studies. Professor Marui has published several books, articles, and research papers on Indian and Buddhist studies. For his invaluable contribution to the study, teaching, research in India's philosophy, thought, history, art, culture, Indian languages, literature, civilization, and society, may I now request the President of India, Mr. Ram Nath Kovind, to confer on Dr. Hiroshi Marui the Distinguished Indologist Award for 2017. The award includes a gold lapel pin, $20,000, and a citation. Dr. Hiroshi Marui. May I request Dr. Hiroshi Marui to please say a few words in acceptance.
First of all, I'd like to express my deepest gratitude to Your Excellency, Sri Ramnath Kovind, President of India, and Your Excellency, Professor Lokesh Chandra, the former former President of ICCL, Your Excellency Srimati Reeva Ganguly Das, General Director, Indian Council for Cultural Relations, and His Excellency Sri Sujan R. Chinoy, Ambassador of India to Japan, and Srimati, Your Excellency Srimati Sushma Swaraj, Minister of External Affairs, all of you for their favorable support and leadership. My deepest thanks also go to all the other Indian ladies and gentlemen, as well as Japanese people who have worked for the realization of this award. Moreover, my best thanks also to all of you who participate in today's memorial ceremony. It is indeed the highest honor and the greatest pleasure as well for me to be granted the Distinguished Indologist 2017. This is really a wonderful gift for me from India and also from the long history of close cultural relationship between India and Japan. I have dedicated more than 40 years to the study of Indian philosophy and religion. Through my research activities, I have encountered many interesting concepts and thoughts that have grown up in the Indian soil. One of them is the idea of three deaths, Rina Traya. It means that the Brahmins are born with three deaths. The debt to the gods should be cleared off by giving offerings to the gods. The debt to our forefathers should be cleared by producing offspring. And the debt to the olden sages should be cleared by studying the Vedas. This idea can be traced back to the 10th century BC as it is found in the Yajurveda. Above all, let me call your attention to the notion of the debt to the olden sages. According to the traditional Indian concept of knowledge, there is principally no knowledge at all which could ultimately be traced back to any individual thinker except to the founder of a branch of learning, Shastrakara. In the case of the Veda, you owe your knowledge of them ultimately to the inspired poets of olden times, rishis, who are supposed to have seen the Vedas. In this view, even if there might be any new knowledge at all, it is possible only on the foundation of traditional knowledge. We are indebted to our forefathers for the original establishment and later successive transmission of our knowledge system. Certainly, we may add new elements to the foundation of knowledge, but these new elements are not entirely due to our innovation. Additional accomplishments are the product of a cooperation between the heritage of traditional knowledge and our interpretation of it in later times. Cooperation between the old and the new. The similar idea is also found in the field of philosophy in India. According to the traditional Indian philosophy, thinking is not a monologue, but dialogical activity. Our individual thought is not an isolated product, but it is in some sense a part of the continuous or historical development of knowledge. Each scholar is, as it were, a runner, an intellectual runner. However, according to the old Indian concept of scholarship, scholar is not an isolated runner, but a member of the relay team. A scholar of each generation may inherit the old tradition of a knowledge system from earlier generation and hand it over to the next generation, just as a relay runner takes a baton from a forerunner of the team and after running a certain allotted distance, the relay runner hands the baton over to the next runner. Today, we are living in a totally different world. Each scholar has to show his or her own original innovation. The succession of intellectual activities from generation to generation is not the point for you to emphasize. Instead, you have to put emphasis upon the difference of what you have done from what the past scientists had done. You are entitled to claim, even for the ownership of your own intellectual achievement. Any particular academic activity belongs to a certain individual or a certain group, not to others. Now, I would not like to emphasize the isolated originality of my academic achievements. I have just been trying to understand what the author of any philosophical text intended to say, or to discover the significance of some phases of Indian philosophy to the contemporary world. However difficult the text was, I never gave up the task of reaching the true understanding of it. Perhaps that was a portion of my own personal efforts and activities, but I acknowledge profound indebtedness to many distinguished Indian or Japanese or Western foreigners or contemporaries for their brilliant clarification and stimulating explanation. Here I mention only two names. First, Dr. Vasishta Narayanazar, a former director of CSS, the University of Pune. He introduced me to the attractiveness of a living Indian philosophy, especially Nyaya Shastra, with his utmost clear elucidation. Second, the late Dr. Hajime Nakamura, the greatest Japanese foreigner for me. He was a guru of my guru, Dr. Sengaku Maeda. One of Dr. Nakamura's outstanding features was his scholarly dedication as a bodhisattva. He never studied for his own fame. He died 18 years ago, but through his profound knowledge and bodhisattva-like dedication to Indian thought and Buddhism, he has constantly been throwing a light, even today, on our path to show how our study of Indian thought should be. Finally, I'd like to share the honor and the delight with all the people who studied or are studying or will hope to study Indian philosophy. This award is a gift as well as a precious encouragement, not only for me, but also for all of them. I do hope today's award will help to broaden and deepen the awareness of the meaning of studying Indian philosophy today. I'd like to spend the rest of my life in that direction. Thank you very much for your attention.
External Affairs Minister, Srimati Sushma Swarajji, Minister of State for External Affairs, General V.K. Singhji, respected Professor Hiroshi Maruiji, Acting President of ICCR, Dr. S. Jayashankarji, Ambassador of Japan, His Excellency, Mr. Kenji Hiram Tasuji, members of the Diplomatic Corps, ladies and gentlemen. I extend a warm welcome to all of you at the Distinguished Indologist Award Ceremony. It is indeed a privilege for me to address this august gathering of eminent scholars and personalities. A few centuries ago, people from different walks of life came together to delve deep into India's ancient past. And so, Indology was born. Scholars the world over have continued to study this academic tradition to understand Indian civilization and its ancient heritage. The Distinguished Indologist Award is a befitting recognition of all scholarly works, past and present, to discover the deeper essence of Indian thought and expression. I compliment the Indian Council for Cultural Relations for this initiative. Ladies and gentlemen, I am delighted to have conferred the third Distinguished Indologist Award on Professor Hiroshi Marui of Japan. That I did so with Lord Buddha blessing us from behind makes it even more special. Professor Hiroshi Marui has spent over 40 years working on Indian philosophy and Buddhist studies. His many acclaimed publications and research papers are considered final authority on several subjects the world over. As the president of Japanese Association of Indian and Buddhist Studies, he has made significant contribution to propagate Indology amongst the youth in Japan. I congratulate him for receiving this prestigious award and compliment him for his exemplary contribution to Indology. It is a matter of great satisfaction for us that the third Distinguished Indology Award has been conferred on a scholar from Japan, a country with which we have had cross flow of ideas, art, literature, and religious philosophy for ages. These have led to deep spiritual affinity and cultural understanding between the two peoples. We have illuminating accounts of Japanese scholars Kibi no Makibi and Kobo Daisi, who are credited for evolving the kana syllabary, having studied Sanskrit from Indian scholars. This could have led to similarities that we see between Devanagari and Japanese syllabary. There are other similarities to be noted too. The sentence in Japanese language is arranged in the same order as in Sanskrit, like subject, that is karta, followed by object, that is karma, and then the verb, that is kriya. This cultural intermingling impacted us as well. With Okakuru Tenzin and his association with Swami Vivekananda and Gurudev Rabindranath Tagore, a new chapter unfolded in Indo-Japanese understanding. Japan's success in modernizing itself while keeping its traditional values intact had deeply impressed both. Today, India-Japan relations have acquired a higher salience. As such, Indology and the works of Professor Hiroshi Marui have become even more meaningful. Ladies and gentlemen, Indology is the study of India, its multifaceted and ancient culture and civilization. It is fascinating how the cross currents of time in the 17th and 18th century led to deep interest among Western scholars to study Sanskrit and ancient Indian texts. Universities in Europe and Orientalists in India sought solace in Upanishadic thought and admired the liberty, sophistication of Santakulam. Monier Williams and others saw in the Ramayana and the Mahabharata the clue to the Indian mind and ethos. Max Muller, the great Indologist, said, and I quote, "If I were asked under what sky the human mind has most fully developed some of its choicest gifts, has most deeply pondered over the greatest problems of life, and has found solutions of some of them which well deserve the attention even of those who have studied Plato and Kant, I should point to India," unquote. Spiritual leaders and social reformers from Swami Vivekananda to Raja Ram Mohan Roy went deep into writings of Indologists and reminded Indians of their ancient heritage. The Indologists brought about a new consciousness in India that ignited self-pride. They became a bridge between India and the Western world. This also encouraged many Indian scholars to take up Indology. Indian culture and its many attributes have evolved over centuries. The depth of time has given it a unique strength and character. It is integral and holistic, synthetic and accommodating. Hence, it could survive the onslaughts of time and transcend the limits of space. Indianness is characterized by inclusive pluralism. It is rooted in the principle of dharmo rakshati rakshita, that is, dharma, or the virtuous order which, when protected, protects all without exclusion. Ladies and gentlemen, today we all live as a global community. There is a greater need for mutual understanding. New ideas are shaping our daily lives. People and policy makers are looking for options to make living more sustainable, one where we have a symbolic relationship with nature and ecology around us. We are digging deep into our traditional knowledge and ancient wisdom to share with the humankind the best of our achievements. India is doing its best to propagate the virtues of yoga and Ayurveda for the well-being of humanity. Likewise, other nations and societies are making efforts to revive their traditional cultural expressions. In such a scenario, Indology assumes greater significance to promote better understanding between peoples and to share what India has to offer to humankind. Indologists over generations have helped in a deeper understanding of India's history and civilization. We are truly grateful to Professor Hiroshi Marui for his contribution to Indology. I am confident that such endeavors will lead to a greater interest in not only study and research of classical Indology, but also study of India in all its aspects. With these words, I would like to once again congratulate Professor Hiroshi Mori. I wish him all success in his future endeavors. Origato, Professor Hiroshi Marui. Thank you. Jai Hind.